Makes a central city neighborhood thrive? What makes a racially integrated neighborhood accommodating? What qualities boost resident pride? These are some of the questions residents will address as they describe the Merrill Park neighborhood in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Merrill Park was not always a central city neighborhood, nor was it always racially integrated. Merrill Park's history began with the railroad. In 1879, the manager of the Chicago, Milwaukee, and St. Paul line purchased a large parcel of land in an area that was then outside Milwaukee's boundaries. Here he built his estate and a chain of railroad shops that would eventually employ 2,500 people. The man's name was Sherburn S. Merrill.
He lived on 33rd and Wisconsin, although 33rd Street didn't go through. Actually, Merrill Park extends from 30th Street west to 35th Street. That was the Merrill estate. And subsequently, about 1880, 1890, it was subdivided up into streets, and housing began to be built here about 1890.
As Merrill began building homes on the estate, the railroad attracted a number of German Protestants to the area. The neighborhood quickly began to generate its own form of social stratification. The houses closest to the railroad tracks were small, one-story dwellings. Moving north, the houses were larger, including a number of towering, ornate duplexes. More diversity would follow. A fire in Milwaukee's Third Ward, coupled with the job opportunities on the railroad, soon prompted a mass migration of Irish Catholic families to the neighborhood, which was now known as Merrill Park.
The Irish that originally came here were from the unskilled, they were unskilled, they were agricultural people, so henceforth they took the jobs on the Milwaukee Road as lesser skilled, but later on they recognized that their sons should become journeymen, become skilled people, because their culture would be much better for them.
My great-great-grandfather started in the railroad in as a boilermaker helper, and it was done back in the 1860s. And then his son Joe was a boilermaker and boilermaker helper, and then my uncle was a machinist there, and then I came there and was an electrician.
Few Irish communities prospered without the strong focal point of the local church. In the 1880s, St. Rose Parish was founded, named after the first Catholic saint in the Americas. In 1893, the original St. Rose School was built. While the Irish may have never comprised a majority of Merrill Park residents, nor was St. Rose the neighborhood's only church, the particular influence of St. Rose Parish and school would transform the neighborhood into one that began to appear distinctly Irish. Writes Milwaukee historian John Gerda, Merrill Park and St. Rose were practically synonymous. Because of St. Rose's dominating influence, Merrill Parkers who were non-Irish, or at least non-Catholic, sometimes felt like outsiders in their own neighborhood. St. Patrick's Day steadily climbed in popularity, Boiled dinners were in nearly everyone's pot, and Merrill Park residents, following the Irish, began taking a profound interest in local government. The influence of the Irish, and in particular, St. Rose's, extended well into the middle of the 20th century.
At St. Rose's, we had wonderful young priests. It was usually their first assignment, and they were so spiritually wonderful, but also so sociably fun. If anyone was sick at your house, they'd come and visit you. And then neighbors next door used to have an ongoing Sunday dinner, and all the priests would just stop in and have dinner at Deemer's house.
Your life centered around parish activities. No matter what the function was, it always had to do with St. Rose.
We had dances and plays and all the different committees, the home and school and the Christian women and ushers and a few more that we all got involved in.
Just before school was out, I should say, late spring, we had a school picnic at Washington Park. And if I remember correctly, it was always on Cannon Hill. And I don't know, it was sort of a reserved spot. One of the activities that we did at the picnic, besides have a lot of fun, was to go to the boathouse and take your favorite nun for a ride in a rowboat.
We always had May altars in school, so we always had one at home, too. From the 1st of May till the end of May, then we had a May crowning in our house. And my sister and I always got flowers and got an orange crate or something, built a May altar every May in our bedroom.
In 1900, the neighborhood lost its suburban status when the city of Milwaukee annexed most of the Merrill Park area. During the early 20th century, Merrill Park continued to add assets. Clybourn Street hosted 4 grocery stores, barbers, a hardware store, a soda fountain, tailors, a men's store, dentists, a doctor, and a plumber. Residents rarely had to leave their neighborhood to shop or to go to work. Employment opportunities were bountiful on the railroad, at nearby hospitals, at local factories. In 1923, the city of Milwaukee purchased a large parcel of land on the western edge of Merrill Park. This area would become the Merrill Park playground. Neighborhood youth had no shortage of recreation.
Merrill Park playground was a very, very important part of our life. It was very close to St. Rose, so when we got out of school, we went right up to Merrill Park, we practiced football, we played basketball, and all the other sports, baseball, softball. We'd go home for lunch during the summer, we'd play, come back, eat dinner, and go right back up there. There was always something going up at Merrill Park.
In 1924, Marquette University High School was moved to the homestead of the now deceased Sherburne Merrill. The high school quickly became the most prestigious Catholic boys' school in the city, and St. Rose students were well represented in the classes.
Well, every year, the first the start of the season, the St. Rose grade school team would play the Marquette freshmen. It was a scrimmage for the freshmen, but it was kind of a big game for St. Rose, and we'd often give them a very good game, and sometimes I think there was several occasions we beat them. That was quite a thing.
Another staple feature of Merrill Park was the pub.
The tavern was a very important element or part of the way of life in Merrill Park, but I don't want you to get the wrong idea of it. Was there drinking? Of course there was drinking. Was there too much drinking? Sometimes there was it, and that stuff wasn't holy water. But it was an integral part of the society, the web of society, because it was a meeting place, and it was a place where there was interaction between people aside from work. Many of these people work side by side in railroad yards or in Falk, but and it was normal that they'd come home from work, and on the way home they'd be walking,
they'd have their favorite tavern, and they'd stop, and the father might have two beers, and he might have a shot, he might have two shots, and then he'd go home for supper. Everybody was home for supper.
At the close of the 1920s, Merrill Parkers, like other Americans, were living through the Great Depression. While some residents lost jobs, many others experienced limited effects.
The railroad during the Depression years actually showed a gain. And Merrill Park was not a very poor, was considered like a poor neighborhood. Merrill Park was very affluent. Most of the people worked at railroads. A lot of the people lived in mansions in Merrill Park and had servants.
It was World War II that would begin to change the makeup of Merrill Park. Hundreds of young residents served. Some died in action. The end of the war brought both joy and something unexpected.
What happened, we had just come out of the Depression years in the 30s, and there was no construction at all during the 30s. When the boys left, they left to go in the service in 40 and 41. When they came back 5 and 6 years later, they were married, they had families, and there was no place for them to live in Merrill Park because there was no building. So consequently, they had to go in the outlying areas where they could find adequate housing for their families.
The loss of many of the older families in Merrill Park would change the population of the area. Milwaukee was growing, and the neighborhood was now situated in the central city. Merrill Park had always experienced some cultural diversity.
The basic element on the Merrill Park were Irish Catholic and later on Italian Catholics, and then still later on Hispanic Catholics.
There were so many different people of different nationalities living in the same block.
But not all groups were welcomed equally.
Well, my father was a railroad man, a railroad porter, and he did a lot of traveling, so they came to Milwaukee in the 1930s.
Although using the word Jim Crow might be putting it a little strong, there was segregation on the Milwaukee Road, and they had different facilities for different people. The African Americans were more or less delegated to lesser jobs.
Well, we were called names. We were mostly called names, and my brother would do a bit of fighting about it when we were called names and different things, but my mother tried to tell us just to ignore it, and she was a church-going person. She went to church every day, so people learned to know her from St. Rose and love her. She was a very special person.
When we first came out to interview the house with the real estate company, my neighbor across the street to my left on the northwest corner, that Tony, he circulated a petition that didn't want us moving in. Only a very few people signed that petition. More people was for us than there were against us. And we were successful in buying the house, and we moved in. After we moved in, we didn't have any problems.
Issues of race and ethnicity would continue to challenge Merrill Parkers. But residents shared certain common experiences that helped people connect. First, young and old played together.
I guess our area is unique in a way, but unlike other areas, since our kids are forced, together in one specific area, they tend to kind of work out their own racial and other interpersonal problems. So we really don't have a large problem with cultural mixture, although there are some separations based on cultural lines. But our kids tend to kind of get along based on the fact that they're thrown together day after day after day. So you learn more and more, you're thrown together. You learn to deal with people basically on a personal level rather than on a racial level.
Second, people worked together.
Well, in 1965, I moved here from a small town in Alabama, and I'd never lived in an integrated neighborhood. And once I moved in, I found out, you know, people can really coexist. And most of the guys that live in the neighborhood worked in the factories where I worked. I worked at Alice Chalmers, and we rode the bus together and would see each other at work, at home, and in the local pubs.
Third, families had the opportunities to invest in their own neighborhood.
They got to know my grandmother, you know, through friends and what have you, and she had a large house, so she would give them a room for the night or two or three nights, however long it took, and feed them. And they were called Gandhis back in those days. You know, they were on the railroad, off and on the railroad. So that started the rooming house as far as, now this is way back. This is, say, like in the 50s.
And it was a positive impact on the race because blacks moved out here and bought homes, and they worked for big companies like Rexnord, Falk, and Harley Davidson and Miller.
And there was something else that helped families connect. Children in Merrill Park were enculturated into deferring to adults, regardless of cultural background.
What was outstanding to me in the Irish families that lived in Merrill Park was the absolute reverence towards the mother in the family. She was just short of being worshipped by the other siblings in the family, by all the siblings in the family. This was a remarkable thing that I'd never seen in other family relationship that existed before.
African Americans in this neighborhood, you have to understand that there was never any real racism. It was everybody was a neighbor. You weren't a racial or ethnic group. People got along, people watched each other's kids. Grandpa Miller somewhat epitomized that.
I remember some kids, there must have been some gang kids in the early 80s, coming down the street, which we never really experienced much of it. And I remember Grandpa Miller with a chain going after these kids with this dog by his side. The kids left, went down the street, and I never saw him after that.
We return to our questions. What makes an urban neighborhood like Merrill Park thrive? What boosts resident pride? Urban scholars claim that a thriving neighborhood must have a strong economic base. Prevailing cultural trends should embrace urban living. Residents need some expectation of shared values and shared activities. Residents need forms of social control. The neighborhood should have strong internal organizations and networks. But sociologists and anthropologists say there is also another factor. Merrill Park residents were well connected to external political institutions.
Generally, they were conservatives, conservative Democrats. There were some people in the area who were not of Irish extraction, who were workers, many of them of German extraction, who lived in the southwest part of Merrill Park, a few of whom became socialists.
We always voted as a block there, and of course we always controlled the county government. We had a little trouble with getting a mayor elected in there, but most of the people that worked in the city hall and worked in the county buildings were people from Merrill Park. We also had representation in state and federal government. The Zeidler family, they were from Merrill Park. We had Carl, who was elected mayor right before the war, and he got killed during the war. Then his brother, Frank Zeidler, was elected after the war.
In one half century alone, Merrill Park produced nearly 100 judges, district attorneys, and state, county, and city legislators, and municipal department heads. Three of four county executives were Merrill Parkers, and three of four Milwaukee mayors were raised in the neighborhood.
The first owners was the family of Mayor Meyer, Henry Meyer. He grew up here as a small boy. I learned this through working for the mayor And by going down, when I purchased the house, I had to go down to the code office in City Hall and get the history of the house.
Merrill Park had the assets to thrive. But despite its history and its people, Merrill Park would change. Residents could not anticipate developments in the larger society. Beginning in the 1950s, the twin forces of urban policy and popular culture would work together to lower the status and vitality of urban life. Two powerful status markers dominated the times: the automobile and the house in the suburbs. The popular media launched messages that the American dream could be captured on Route 66 or behind the Cleavers' picket fence. The dominance of the automobile ultimately led to the demise of the railroad in Merrill Park. And government policy would play its role in urban flight.
When all of a sudden the freeway was coming through Merrill Park, and it was an exciting time because it meant that people from the central city could go, they could go any place. We could go any place on that freeway. That's what they were promising us. And so it kind of made us think about what was possible in terms of travel. What we didn't realize till some time later was what effect that it would have on Merrill Park. It came in, it took housing, unbelievably nice housing, ripped it apart. And what I think we found today is that freeway, it benefits us some, but mostly what happens, it's for others, for people to go through our neighborhood and use our neighborhood. And so much housing went down and people were moved out, and it changed the whole sense of direction of Merrill Park.
Other major employers of Merrill Park residents were its 8 area hospitals. One by one, these hospitals shut down or moved when Milwaukee County built a massive medical complex outside the city limits. Hospital workers followed their jobs. Government policy would also begin transporting children away from their neighborhood through school busing.
I really think busing is one of the worst things that could happen to a neighborhood, simply because you got a kid getting up at 6 o'clock in the morning, get ready for school. He stands 20 minutes on the bus line, and like next door to me, there's 3 kids, and none of them ride the same school bus to school.
Adults began losing their check on children.
When we went to St. Rose, if we did something wrong, the teachers could hit our hands or spank us or punish us. Then the neighbors would do it if we did something wrong next door or down the street. And when we got home, we'd get another, you know, spanking or what have you. Nowadays, with the government saying that you cannot spank your children, and the children know it from day one, they have no control. Parents have no control over the children. And so neither do the neighbors or anyone else.
St. Rose, while still vibrant, struggled to avoid segmentation in serving Catholics of diverse traditions. As more of the older families left Merrill Park, so did the local businesses.
People that moved in didn't have the money to support the businesses, so the businesses just closed.
And pretty soon, the discount stores came along, and pretty soon you could shop on Sunday as well. And it was that people no longer stayed in the neighborhood. They went out to find the things that they needed and do their one-stop shopping. And it now those stores are vacant and not the same. It just doesn't have that feeling where you can just pop out and do it in your own neighborhood. You have to leave the neighborhood to get the services that you want.
The gradual loss of the neighborhood's economic base left it open for predatory interests.
big business moved into Milwaukee and started buying up all the homes. They wouldn't take care of them. They had several different kind of roofing patches they had on their homes. They had different four or five different kinds of siding on the houses. They wouldn't paint them. They wouldn't take care of the inside. And all he did was collect the rents. We had one builder in here. He owned about 100 houses in the Merrill Park area. And he let all of his houses go run down.
There's a lot of the older people moved out, and younger families moved in, and the kids got into the gangs. There were points where there were shootings, drive-by shootings taking place, and the people were afraid, and they were afraid to speak out.
We had prostitution that moved in the area off the avenues, and they were coming in the neighborhood, and Johns were soliciting young women, mothers, pregnant women.
But even in the worst of times, some Merrill Parkers remembered their heritage. Residents that remained in Merrill Park continued to fight for the neighborhood. When Harley Davidson threatened to leave the area, residents organized. Residents united to fight against crime.
They took a stand, and people like Ruth Paquette, Janet Alberti, Marlene Cohn, others, Sister Lucy, they took a stand and started really bringing this up to the surface and took them on, let people know who these Johns were that were being arrested, and scared them out of the area. Typical of the, indicative of the personality of Merrill Parkers.
People, all the neighbors were coming over my house right here. We're meeting here, and we started discussing how we were going to take care of things, and one thing led to another, and Bobby Green suggested that we, about getting Merrill Park going. So we all pooled together and got Merrill Park Association going.
Between Merrill Park, my friend and I, we wrote to the drug abatement and sent as much information as we could to the various organizations dealing with the drug house. And last year, I believe it was finally, no, it's been a year and a half. It finally was rescued.
And the political connections to outside institutions continued to help the neighborhood. Some youth and family activities have been revived through funds from the outside institutions and through resident activism.
Activities that the Near Downtown Resource Center does consist of an association with MPS programs as far as basketball, baseball, soccer, tennis, and the programs that MPS has.
The competitions in the Mini Olympics, it's given them a sense of pride, and I see the difference in a lot of the children that, they got strive, they got goals, which I think some of the kids had lost.
Our backyard was the neighborhood gym for many years. It still is. We still have a lot of kids in there. We've got a trampoline and all the gymnastic equipment, a tree with a rope in it, and so we taught a lot of kids gymnastics, and we also set up a program at St. Rose for about 8 years, two afternoons a week with the trampoline at the school and teaching them other sports.
The neighborhood continues to be one of the most diverse in Milwaukee. A new population has arrived, the Hmong, a horticultural group from the mountains of Southeast Asia. The Hmong add a fascinating new cultural fiber to the neighborhood. However, many of the features that helped forge bonds in the past, the deference to adults of any background, the strong economic base, no longer apply. Neighborhood politics and social life remain, but clearly not all residents feel the same comfort level.
I suppose there is a feeling of inferior and most African Americans don't want to be put in that situation of feeling inferior. So there's no commitment on their part.
Nothing is done that we would like, you know, to have done toward the African American more.
I'm down here, I'm in Milwaukee, and I don't really know people. I don't really know about this place that's it.
They are from different country, and they feel more comfortable staying with their own group, and they have their own interest in sport. That's made they stay in their own group.
Ethnic and race relations continue to demand the Merrill Park spirit of activism.
What happened is that we had Hmongs on the playground and African Americans and whites. So, but what happened is that they really didn't understand each other. They didn't understand the games, and there was some tension. So what the Resource Center did was hired an Asian who is pretty good at understanding English, and he also speak Hmong and Thai. So that was, we got it pretty much eliminated. Now we have Hmong kids and African Americans and white in the Resource Center.
Despite ongoing challenges, the neighborhood is coming back. There are two things that the overwhelming majority of Merrill Parkers agree on. First, former residents honor the time they spent in the neighborhood. Scores of Merrill Parkers meet at least once a month just to talk about the old times. Second, current residents want to stay.
I was glad to raise my child in the Merrill Park area because of the diversity. There was not only German descent, there was Irish, Italian, Spanish, African American, and everyone got along.
Pienso que sí, estamos, no sé, tratando de vivir aquí, sí, porque la vecindad es buena, me parece que es buena.
This particular house here is willed to all of the children, but the boys got together and decided to give it to my oldest daughter because she's handicapped and they want her to have this house.
There was a young lady that worked at the drugstore. I must have been a junior in high school, and she said, "Why do you live in this crummy neighborhood? This is so terrible. You should be in a nice house in suburbia." And I said, "No, I really like Merrill Park. Look at, they have all these great friends. Place to be." She says, "As soon as you get a chance, you're going to move out of Merrill Park. I just know it." And I said, "Well, no, I don't think so." She says, "Well, what if you want a better house?" I said, "I'll make the house that I'm in better." And she says, "Well, what if you just don't want to live in the city anymore? What if you want more space?" I said, "I'll go to a park. That's okay." And she couldn't believe that I was going to stay here. And that every once in a while comes into my mind, and I have to tell myself, I don't have to tell myself, I have to, it's real interesting. Yes, I have stayed here, and I have a nice house, and I have a nice park, and so it's great being in Merrill Park.
I'm looking over a four-leaf clover that I overlooked before. One leaf is sunshine, the second is rain.